वेरी गुड मॉर्निंग टू ऑल ऑफ यू. वेलकम टू आवर फर्स्ट एज्योर सेशन टुडे. एंड टुडे ऑनवर्ड्स वी आर स्टार्टिंग आवर एज्योर मॉड्यूल वेयर वी विल लर्न मेनी मेनी टॉपिक्स. टुडे मोस्ट प्रोबेबली थियरी एंड फाइनली आई विल टेल यू, बट टुमारो ऑनवर्ड्स प्रैक्टिकल्स विल स्टार्ट. बट टुडे मोस्ट प्रोबेबली थियरी टॉपिक्स वी आर देयर विच वी हैव टू कंप्लीट. सो एंड फॉर दिस आई ऑलरेडी टोल्ड यू हैव टू prerequisite is ASP.NET MVC. Minimum concepts are required, and as well as you should have the SQL Server minimum knowledge and HTML knowledge. These are the minimum things you have to know. Okay, so good morning Sai Raghavendra, after a long time I'm meeting you again. Amit, Dipali, Ashok, Devi, and from Paris, Pavitra, Kiran from Malleshwaram, Dharmendra, good morning to all of you. And today, Jay Prakash, yes, this is the first class, Jay Prakash from Rajaji Nagar. Akash, good morning from City Center. So, some of you, Jay Prakash, like that, who are not part of ASP, are you the part of ASP, Jay Prakash? Jay Prakash, I want you, because I have told most of everybody on the day of intro of Azure that you have to send me the details for Azure subscription by creating one Outlook or Hotmail.com, where only 8 students of the batch were sent. And till tomorrow I'll wait, and afterwards don't expect from me any help, okay, regarding the subscription to be added for your account. For these 8 students, I'm just reading the names of the students who sent me the details, in which order they sent is first Joshine, Dharmendra Kumar, Preeti Shilori, Prashanti Patil, Dikali Bharat Kedar, Bitika Hazra, Priyanka Hazra, and Ashok Sudak. Okay. So these are the 8 students who were sent me the details for the subscription. Rest of the students' details I did not get it. Devi, you sent. At what? When did you send? Devi, and when did you send? Can you write me the date? Because so you please join in the group. You will come to know what you have to do first. Sayal, you have sent me the mail. Why did you send to my Gmail? I don't check for the MIT student details from my Gmail, and you are not supposed to send to my Gmail. You should send to my MIT.com. Okay, same Savitri.Dudala, instead of Gmail.com you should send it to MIT.com. okay, Borivali Center Sayali, you send it to my MIT student MIT.com, so I will check. Three batch, okay, you are the three batch. Have you completed ASP? Jay Prakash, did you complete ASP? Hema Singh, Gurgaon Center, ID. I did not get anything from you, Hema. Center ID you are asking, which I am not getting. So without the knowledge of ASP, Azure is difficult to understand, okay, because the entire coding is ASP, and I'm not going to explain that ASP code which you have learnt already in ASP. So that's what, Kiran, please join in our group so that you get the details what you have to send it to me. So what are the so let me write our group name over here so that you, it will be easier for you to where in it. Devi, you also recent once Saturday you sent, no? Okay, once again I'll check. If I did not find, better you send once again, okay? Just forward it, enough. And I'm writing the group name here. So group name is over there. Please note down the group name, PGP V3_2_Azure. This is your group name. You can join to this group so that I have mentioned there what are all you have to do for the Azure subscription, without which you can't do the practicals. But first two chapters, you don't require the Azure subscription to do it. But later chapters, you must require the Azure subscription. Okay. So that's why as early as possible, if you send, I'll help you out. Otherwise, I can't. Yeah, sure. Devi, you can post it in the group also. Don't worry. Okay? I will take it from the group also. In our Azure group, you post it. So let us start our session today. So only 8 students' details only I got it. Rest of the students' details, if you are not sending, you feel that you don't require to do the practicals, means don't send it. And afterwards, now nobody is allowed to blame me. Because long back I told this information in the Azure intro session. So now I'm starting my session, which I don't want to spend much time on this. So I'm sharing the slides. The first one will be, we'll be having the complete theoretical topics only. In this session, most of the things are theoretical. And actually in the first session only, second chapter also need to be started. But max of it we will not be able to complete. Only first chapter we can complete. And here, we cannot say that each one is a chapter. We should say it as module 1, module 2, module 3, like that. And first, for 2 minutes, I want to show you what are the books that you need to refer from your cloud courseware. Okay? So those books I will share with you and I'll show you from my cloud courseware for the stuff. From their books names, I will show you. Please refer from there. You start reading from the day 1 onwards. And some of the configuration settings, some theoretical parts, everything might not be explained by me because it's like a version. Very important practicals, everything I'm going to tell you. It's your duty to read day by day the theory, what we have, till where we have completed, I'll tell. So you need to complete reading on the same day. Okay? So first I will share my system to show you what book you need to refer for this module. So I'm sharing my system, just wait. I'm just sure, just wait. You can see the books now. Just wait, I'll show you the books. So don't expect that all these are Azure books. Only few are Azure books. What are those books for Azure? I'm just pointing the, see, this is the lab guide where step-by-step solution for each and every question and exercises that you have to practice for lab at home are available. If you are doing all the activities, which are all the activities from this, so activities I'll teach. But exercises you need to practice based on the activities, whatever I'm teaching. So the same steps will be there, but on a different project. So these two, you see, these are the real student guide 1 and student guide 2. The name of the book is, this is e-learning guide. That means own learning, some of the concepts will be there, which you have to learn in the Azure. But this is what's developing Windows, Azure, and Web Services student guide part 1. And part 2 is also there, part 2. Total 12 modules are there in your course. There are 12 modules. So I want to show you those modules names also. First book, Student Guide 1, will have 8 modules. Rest of the modules will be available in the Part 2 book. Okay, but practicals related, all the lab activities of all the two books will be available in your single lab guide itself. So, okay, let me decrease the size so that you can easily see. So now you see, you can see the contents. Can you see the contents that, see, this is the module 1, and remember in the module, so here chapter is, we will call it as module 1. The module name is Overview of Service and Cloud Technologies, like that. In that, again, topics are divided into lessons. Lesson 1, lesson 2, lesson 3, lesson 4, lesson 5, all these together is one chapter in general, okay? So like that, module 2, module 3, like that, total how many modules do you have on the whole for your Azurist? Total 12 modules you have. See, these are advanced topics actually. You need to concentrate and listen. Here, there are 12 modules. Module 12 is what? Scaling services, which is the simplest chapter. But rest of the chapters, one chapter will take around 2 classes like that. In case we are unable to complete at any point of time, we have to take the extra sessions also in between. So you may, so anytime don't say that, madam, I have another class like that. In case you feel that we are going slow, we have to take the additional classes. At that time I'll tell, but immediately I'll not tell that you will be having the extra classes always. In case we are going little delayed at any point of time, then we will take the extra classes or some of the demos we will see in the Cloud Connect. Okay, this is the procedure we will use. This is about in the book that you have to refer. And the lab guide, I already told you, for activities step-by-step solution he will give, but for exercises which are part of your lab at home, you have to do on your own. Okay, so data files you need to ask at your center, as because they are very huge size, so that I cannot put it in the group. It is very difficult for me to pass those data files. You please ask at your center. In case they are having the problem, you ask them to write a mail to me, a group leader to me, so that I will see some solution to send the data files. Okay, most of the times actually I don't have the data files for some. If I'm having, I'll send it. Okay, so I think it's clear to all of you. The communication clear, or do you have any doubts? So some of you are very new for this session. I think we who were not attended for the intro session, that's the reason these many doubts you are getting. In this module of Azure, you have to do the practicals even in the Azure portal. There is a website called as Azure portal where you have to do the practicals. So you need to log in into that website. It is only possible if you have an account to enter into that. So that is nothing but already existing Hotmail or Outlook.com IDs for which Azure subscription to be added by us. So if you create the account, we will provide you the subscription, then you can do the practicals in the Azure portal, otherwise it's impossible. So how you need to create user ID and password, I have written in the group, please go through, and I don't want to waste the time or here, because long back I have already confirmed, and I kept the details even in the group. Please check from there. Okay, Akash. So now we are starting with our session, and I am disconnecting this, and I am showing you the presentation. So what are the topics you are learning from here, you can check. So these are the ones, this is the complete actually, so many objects are there, as because as you are already aware of ASP, what do you mean by distributed application? Some of you already know, so it is little faster. See, actually whatever I am exploring, till here, this is the first chapter. From here, whatever you are doing, that is module 2 actually. Okay, so we will try to complete module 1 at any cost in today's session, and the rest of the part of this, actually in this today's session, we need to start second module, which is not possible as per our current situation. So I will start this entity model, and before coming to the tomorrow session, you should go through the a chapter of your ESP, that is the code first approach, model first approach, database first approach, three I explain you in the entity framework. That you go through ESP and then you come, so that you will feel very easy to complete this task, because I'm not going to explain all this which I have been explained in your ESP. So that further actions only we are going to see here. Okay, so now we are seeing with what do you mean by distributed applications. See, each topic has subtopics also, that's what we are going to see. The first thing is, it's about key components of distributed application. But first of all, we should know what do you mean by distributed application. An application which is created where most of the components of it is distributed into multiple systems. So like entire architecture applications. where the business logic is distributed into many systems, and the presentation logic agile are divided into two partitions, presentation layer and presentation logic layer, like that. And where my application, most of the code, everything I'm not preparing, some of the code which I'm using in my program is done by some third party component. Somebody has created some functionalities. Same type of function, if I want, instead of I am making that function, I am accessing the function which is created by a third party person. So that means what? If I'm having some 100 functionalities I implemented in my application, it does not mean that all the 100 functions coding I implemented. Some of around 40% of the functions I have taken which are created by others. So I'm using those third party functions in my application for using. So my application might be having 100 functions, but developer of it, if 40% of the functions are taken from outside person, that means third party components. So those are called as services. So when somebody is creating, somebody can use them in their application. So that is a reusable component. So my application logic is distributed not in one computer, it is distributed into multiple servers. Then it is a distributed application. Why these distributed applications miss, that time you need to know the advantages of this. You see here, characteristics of distributed applications and logical layers of distributed applications. When you know, you will understand how good our distributed application is. Karen, I will tell you, just wait. This I was explained in the last intro class, but I will tell you in today's session only you will get it, okay? Karen, if you wait, it will be better. Why? Because in today's session you will get why we are learning Azure, okay? So before I am not started, whatever you are learning, it is not Azure actually, okay? So your Azure will be coming after understanding this is a distributed application. So characteristics of the distributed application, if you see, modern, all the modern applications nowadays are distributed applications only, and they consume data from distributed sources. That's what, are you understanding? They are taking the data not from one place, they are taking data from multiple sources and doing their task. So they don't expect that everything should be with me. So sometimes some are providing some items, let me take and let me do it. A simple example, I am having one bike manufacturing company. So in the bike, many parts will be there, things, so that mirror will be there, what handles will be there, tires will be there, engine of that will be there, like that many, many things are there, but everything, each and every nut and bolt onwards, everything manufactured by me and creating the bike means is very difficult, it consumes time. So what I will do, there are certain companies, especially they will go for nuts and bolts creation. Some will go only for tires company, MRF tires, like that, Ace tires, like that, some tires are there. So I will give the contract to them to provide the tires for me. I will give contract to some other company to provide the nuts and bolts. I'll give contract to somebody else for getting the mirrors which can be arranged over there in my bike. So those I'm not managing. I'm just giving the contract and getting that from them and paying for that. So all these I'm implementing in my bike. So everything you only created, you don't expect. You are utilizing the services which are provided by others also as part of your bike manufacturing. That is what distributed. So everything is, you did not do. You have gathered the requirements from different sources and you have made your application ready. That is what distributed application. And what is the advantage of this one is many things all of you observe. Scalability, low latency, availability, reliability and security and privacy. Let me explain you one by one. Scalability means things of the same application, if thousands of users simultaneously at same website, if thousands of users, server, only one server is there and thousands of people are accessing that website, and after some time you can see that the application works very slowly, because previously 10 or 20 members are accessing it, now thousands of people are accessing only one server, so it will work slowly. But still, if 1,000 or 2,000, 3,000, 1 lakh people are accessing, still the performance should not degrade, means that is called as scalability. How many members are accessing doesn't matter, it should work very, very fastly. That is called as scalability. Without degrading the performance, if the number of users who are accessing it are increased, then it is always the best. That is called as scalability of your application. If it is 10 people or 1000 people also, it should work that much fast only. Okay, that is scalability. Low latency. First of all, what do you mean by latency? You need to understand. I gave a request to the server. Server takes some time to process your request and get the result. So the mean time between your request and response is called as a latency. But this latency is more means what? The server is taking too much of time to process your request and giving the reply. But as a customer, I expect low latency. If I am creating distributed applications, low latency will be there, which means as soon as you give a request, response will be provided by your server without any delay in between. So that is low latency. Low latency is good. That is provided by what applications? Distributed applications. Okay. And if it is availability. Availability is very, very important. Let me take one of the students on it. Good morning, Joshine and Kiran. Okay. Kiran from Malleshwaram. Let me take him on it. Kiran? Kiran, you are on it. Okay, very good. Yeah,
good morning.
Yeah, very good morning, Kiran. My question is, think so that there is some yahoo.com website is there. One server. There will be one server for yahoo.com. It is not your computer's server. Through the internet, you are connecting to yahoo.com web server and trying to access the website. Due to some problem, the Yahoo server is not working. Can you able to access it? Yahoo server is not working. So can you access it? No. Am I able to access?
No.
No. Anybody access in this world, nobody can access. But that means it is the customer feel very bad. Right? The customer really feels. If it is half an hour, it is not working also. Within this half an hour, crores of people might work with that. Everybody gets dissatisfied. So as a good person of the web, the yahoo.com developer, think so that I am the developer of that yahoo.com who created that website. I don't want to give any time. It should be available throughout 24 hours, throughout 365 days of the year without any problem to the customer. But can I ensure that my server never will get problem? We cannot ensure that the server will not get problem. There might be chance that problems might come. But still, my user is able to access, should be able to access means I should make the backup server. Are you understand? Backup server means what? I'll maintain not one server, I'll maintain 2-3 servers in my Yahoo to serve the Yahoo. But one I make it as the primary, all others are backup servers. If the primary server has some problem to work, then automatically without knowing to the customer, questions needs to request to be redirected to the backup server. So backup server will help you. You don't know. You don't know that backup server is working. But really primary server is not working. But still you are able to access the Yahoo.com because of the backup server. So as a good developer, we should provide multiple servers. So one server is feasible to work, other servers immediately should work for the customer. Then the customer doesn't know that there is some problem was happening in the primary server or like that. They don't know. Once the primary server is problem resolved, immediately again your request must be passed to the primary server only. That means if you are making some backup server, what will happen? So that today I am the cashier in ICICI Bank. Due to some reason, today I was absent. Hundreds, thousands of customers are there. They will be dissatisfied. So one more backup person is there as a cashier. What will happen? That person will take care of this work, right? So customer will not get affected because yeah. For every work, one backup person should be there in any very reputed companies. So one, due to some reason, if the first person is the primary person is unable to come, the same work can be carried by a backup person. Okay. So that is what availability, making many servers available as a backup server. So main server is not working, this backup server will take the help, will help you. So that is called as available. That means throughout 365 days, throughout 24 hours, every day, you are able to access the application means that is only possible, that process is called as availability. That feature is called as availability. So see, ATM machines 24/7 availability builder. That means every time we are available is a min, right? Weekly, every day, every minute we are available. This is also meaning availability of the server means in case there is a failure in the primary server, backup server should be provided by you, then only it is called as availability, more availability application. So that is possible in the distributed applications because they maintain more than one server. One server is not working also, other servers will help you out to do your task. Got my point? Availability means understood? Availability means your server must be available to everyone throughout the 365 days, every day 24 hours, every minute it should work, no time, net down we should say. Not net down, internet is there but website I am unable to access. That means it's a server down. But that concept not to be driven means that is called as availability, always available. There is no problem anytime, every time I am able to access my application. That is called as availability. That is possible in distributed 100% success. Because multiple servers will be there. Clear, Kiran? What about others? Anybody is having doubts, raise your hand. Anybody is having the doubts, please raise your hand. Availability means throughout the any moment, every second it should be available. My server, network, that is server down. Network down, don't say. Internet is there, but I am unable to access a specific website. Other websites I am able to access. That difference you should not get it. Ankit Raj, now you have come. Good morning. But tomorrow onwards you are not allowed to come late, okay? Okay, Ankit. Now we are moving to ahead. Where we are going to see the other concepts also. What are the other concepts can you see now? Reliability and security. Reliability means you can understand every time my application should work without any failure. And if the power cut also, any transaction was started before the transaction means 4-5 works together is a transaction thing. 2 works it has completed successfully, meanwhile power cut. So these two also must be cancelled. Compulsory, that is called as a reliability. Think so that a work was started and all the 4 tasks of the transaction is finished and it's about to make it permanent, the power cut. But still after the power comes, it should become as a success. That means committed. That is called as reliability. So which I want to imply, that is possible because of your distributed applications. The last and final is security and privacy. Can anybody tell the difference between security and privacy? I want anybody raise your hand who is ready to give the difference between security and privacy. So everybody will think that both are same, but both are not same. Security and privacy, nobody is having that doubt. Clarity about security and privacy. So security is what, you know, when you open your application and directly it should not be openable, it should ask user ID and password. If it is checked that your user ID and password is correct, then only you are allowed to work with your application. That is security. Unauthorized users are not allowed to work with that. Privacy means what? So some information is very important which is not to be viewed by others. I want to hide those documents in such a way that you are not allowed to view this information. Even though you are my company employee, this is some secured info, that privacy information of mine which I don't want to share with others. Those are called as privacy. That means others are not allowed to view your data, and others are not allowed to modify your content. Might be if they are seeing also no problem, but they are not allowed to modify my content. I am sending a mail to my boss with some information where I have written 1 lakh and somebody is able to access my mail and do the modification and send it to my boss. Means what? There is no privacy. They are able to see and they are able to modify my content also. So I am writing as 1 lakh, they are making it as 10,000 and they are sending, or they are making as 10 lakhs and sending. So there is no privacy. I want a kind of privacy where people are either unable to read, or if they are reading also no problem, but they are unable to modify my content. That is called as privacy. So don't get confused for privacy and security. First of all, as an authorized, authenticated and authorized person is allowed to access, and that's to what only for which he or she entitled to access the data only. That privacy data cannot be, you cannot view the privacy data of others. So that is the difference between security and privacy. All these can be implemented in the distributed applications. So our Azure ASP.NET MVC applications are also what distributed applications only we'll call. Any doubts, please raise your hand and tell me. I'm waiting for your queries. If you have any doubts, you can raise your hand. Whoever is on time, whoever is late, it's your punishment that you have to learn on your own. Okay? Anybody is having doubts in this distributed application characteristics? Still, lesson one is not finished. After this, see, I'm not talking module one. In the module one, lesson two, lesson three, lesson four, fourth lessons are there. Five is, that is only practical, so that is not there. In that also, one fourth is not, so lesson one is not finished in the module one. We need to finish module one. Any doubts? Low latency, Kiran. I think I have told you. What is 2 into 5, Kiran? What is 2 into 5?
10 now.
You are very bad latency. I gave, after giving the question, how much time you took to give me the response? You are the server and the client, you think so. I gave the question, what is 2 into 5 means it took lots of time. After I gave the request, how much time you have taken to respond for my question? The time, this time gap between request and response is latency. Okay? Are you understanding? It
okay.
should be more or less. It should be more or less actually.
It should be less.
That's what low latency means. Very fast response we will get from the server. Understood? After I gave the request, how much time it is taking to respond to my request? So if distributed as applications means multiple servers also might be there. One server between is another server will take up my work. So I will get the response very faster. So that is low latency. Low latency means the time between the request and response will be very less. So I'm getting the response very fast. My application is working very fast. My server is responding very fast. Okay? Got my point? In
okay,
normal application, server will take much time. High latency will be there, which is not acceptable. So, okay. So now we are seeing what in this one only, another topic in the lesson one only. So what do you mean? Any application, this is completed in our ASP. Any application, web application, you take it. It is divided into layers. And we have learned already some layers in any application, data layer, business logic layer, user interface layer means presentation layer. These three you have learned, only one you have not learned, that is service layer. Any application you take it, it is divided into data layer which interacts with the database for retrieval or saving our information to database or retrieving the information. Either one, if you want to interact, user cannot directly interact with the databases. It is only happens through the data layer. Well and good. But user's request, who will process, who will take the user's request, understands what is the requirement and decides to where the request needs to be transferred is your business logic layer. The main code is your business logic layer. So many of the people will come and send the request to server. Server, I will not directly send. I will send it to the business logic where decision will be taken from where to where I need to transfer the request. Everything, main content, traffic work, that means main decisions, calculations, everything you will perform in the business logic layer. That's the reason it is called as business logic layer. Okay. So this is also called as application logic layer, business logic layer, or business layer, which we have learnt in our ASP. And final one is what? Okay, all these are okay, but how the user will interact, how the client will send their request, from where they will view their response sent by the server. Is it in the air? No. They have to give their request and wait for the response. From where they give the request, so they will take the help of the screens, that means user interface screens. From there, user can interact with your business logic layer, saying that I want this, I want that. So they will press, they will write some data, they will click on some buttons. That is user's request. User is interacting with some screens from where they are passing their request, which will be taken by your business logic layer and performs the task. Okay, so user can interact with what pages to give their request and get their response. Those screens will call it as user interface layer. Users are interacting with those layers, so they never directly goes to business logic, they never directly interact with data layer. Users will utilize presentation log user interface layer to pass their request. Request will go to business logic layer. Business logic layer will understand is anything required from the database or not. If required, it will transfer to the required data layer and get the response and convert into required format, sends to your user interface for display purpose in look and feel good. Okay, that is the first one. Certain times, so you gave the request from UI, that means user interface. Business logic is checking that as per the norms of the company, whatever transaction you are doing, that should be in within working hours, that is 9 o'clock to evening 5 o'clock. But you are doing outside of this time. You are giving your request outside of this working hours. So business logic layer only will cancel the, that means will reject the your request, saying that the working hours, you are not in the working hours, so this process cannot be done right now. It is not required to send to the database and doing the transaction, because as per the norms of company, you are not allowed to do the transaction outside of before 9 o'clock in the morning or after 5 o'clock in the afternoon, evening. So, but you are given the request at that time, means then it should be rejected. So all these will be taken care of by business logic. And as I already told, in business or distributed applications, most of the programming, instead of the developer is implementing, developer of that application is not going to implement. They will access that functionalities from a third party, which either he might be created or she might be created or somebody else created, but which made them to be accessible through internet to access. So what we can have, so those can be used from your application. So this reusable components, whatever you are creating, are called as services. Service means I am creating some functions which I want to make it to be available to all, anybody can access. So I'm called as I created a service, which can be as a reusable component, which others can use the functionalities from there. But how they can send their request to the my services? Through the service layer. This service layer acts as a mediator between your business logic and the services. Your business logic wants to access some of the functionalities from your service, whereas the mediator is what? Service layer. So any third party elements which are reusable components, if you want to access, you should take the help of the service layer, with which interaction between the business logic and the third party service elements might happen, so that you can utilize in your application all those data. If these layers are clear, because these layers are nothing new, we have learnt in our previous ASP time only. Single tier architecture, two tier architecture, three tier architecture, entire architecture, that time before to the, all these, we have learned that a application can be divided into three layers, that is the place, user presentation logic layer, business logic layer, and data layer we learned. But only service layer we did not learn, that is what is explained here as an additional, because we are working with distributed applications. Any doubts, please confirm me. I want everybody to confirm. So better I'll write as a question. so that you can give the answer for that question. See, any doubts on the at that moment only you ask. Until the end of the module, don't keep it with you, okay? Feel free and communicate with all the four layers of any application. There is a question in front of you for all of you, and this is the first one, last time I'm telling. Most of the students are late today to the session. I have seen that on time at 11 o'clock, only 11 students are available for the session. That's true, out of 11 also, 2-3 students came after 9, but before 9-3 like that. But it is not allowed from next class onwards. Be on time so that you will not miss even a single topic. So, who is, did not give answer? Gurga, Moldlf, guess 02. And for some of you, question is not visible. Means you raise your hand and answer me. Okay. And from Ashok Vittal from Kothur, Dipali from Kothur, Nirosha from Trichy Center. Four of Ashok, Dipali and Nirosha. If the question is not visible to you, raise your hand and answer, my dear. Ashok, Dipali and Nirosha. So three of you only did not give, even Gurgaon Center student has given. Everybody is positive. Okay, let me check. Nirosha, yes. Ashok, there is a techno. Okay, but did you understand or not? Shubhangi. Okay, Shubhangi. So Srimati, you have written something due to network problem from your center, something you wrote. Once again you write, please. I'm moving ahead. Before that you write once. Srimati, you have written some message before I'm reading. It has been cleared. You write once again. I'll check. Okay, no responses. So I'm moving ahead. Okay, I think due to network failure, our batch members are all late to the session. Okay. Very good, that towards others we are writing. So now, what are the, now in the word only answer is there, please check, this is lesson 2, it's about data and data access technologies. Data technologies means where, what are the data storage areas, where can you store your information, either students' information, employees' information, courses' information, discounts' information, and fees information, anything in my company, I want to store that one in Tableau for some format. Might be in Tableau format, might be in the plain text Excel format, like that. So what are the different places I can use, in which order I can store, as in Tableau format you can store, or hierarchical, XML data, you know, you can maintain the information in the tree format, that means hierarchical, parent element in that child element. Again, in the parent element, child elements, attributes like that, you know that is hierarchical data information. So you can represent in the Tableau format or plain text format or hierarchical format, however you like. Objects, your class objects are there. You know what is a class, you can know how to create an object, you know how to assign the values to that. What are those objects? Objects, entities of, that means object entities in your .NET. Like that, many the ways are there to store your information, but what are the data storages? Where can you store this data? Might be relational databases, might be non-relational databases, might be plain text, might be XML format, might be class objects, like that, many different ways are there to store your information. Data stores, okay. Cache memory, where you can put some information, even I can access from the cache memory, we have seen in the ASP also. Caching will improve the performance of your application. Some data you can put it very frequently, accessible data, you put it in cache memory. Next time, don't disturb the server, take it from the cache memory. All these are called as data storage. Okay, that means where you are storing the data, well and good. But how to access the data from my application? Data is there in SQL Server, data is there in some plain text forming in Notepad, data is there in my list object of my application in the cache memory. How I can access? There are many techniques also there for you. In the C# we learned file organization. How many of you remember? I don't know. Text mode file organization, binary mode file organization. You are working with the IO files, input output files, for reading and writing plain text, but not they're not in tabular format, normal plain text. That time you have used system.io namespace to work with those files. Sometimes my data might be in the plain text format, so I must use IO. Sometimes if it is the long back, if you want to work from your ASP applications to connect to your databases, there is a programming technique called as ADO.NET coding. ADO.NET in those days. So you need to write coding to establish the connection between your application and database, and you need to write a SQL query to do either insert or delete or update or retrieve the records, whatever you want. You need to write the query, execute the query, get the results. What you want to do, you can do. That much code you have to write. But that connectivity and all these to make it easy, what is the latest concept we got in ASP? Entity framework. That is also data access technologies. We have link. From any type of data source, I can access using the standard query technique. So like that, we have many, many access technologies. Where we store is different, how you can access from there is different. So that is one is accessing data. Where you can put the data is data technologies. And from how you can access the data is data access technologies. So let us see what are those. See here, data can be presented in different modes, either it is relational, that means tabular format, okay? And hierarchical means XML, object oriented means I told you that you will create classes and you will create objects for them. You are maintaining the data in the format of the object, so that is object oriented, okay? So there are many different techniques how you will represent your data either in tabular format or in XML format or in the object oriented format, entities format. But where are you going to, whatever might be, finally you need to put this information somewhere. Where are you going to do? If it is generally databases like that, you will take relational databases or NoSQL, means don't get confused, non-relational SQL databases. So relational databases will be there, non-relational databases, okay, both will maintain the data in the tabular format. So either if it is relational data, generally I will take relational databases or NoSQL. Or general plain text format means file system and distributed file system. Normal text files like that, BMP files like that. Okay, and distributed cache means what? Cache memory. Distributed cache memory means what? There is a server and there are many clients. There are three or four servers might be there, you think so. Once, but every server's cache memory is limited. So not that too much you don't, but some information which I want to put it in the cache memory. Whose size is greater than how much free space is there in the cache memory? Then some part of your data can be kept in that server's cache and rest of it can be put in the cache memory of the other server also. That means even you are distributing your data in the multiple cache memories of multiple servers. That is distributed cache. Okay. And cloud, this is what our entire Azure model, you people can understand from this cloud storage. Are you understanding? The entire work is you are going to learn cloud storage. What is the advantage of cloud storage? I want to tell later. Why? Because you will understand what are the drawbacks in these earlier ones, how it is rectified in the cloud storage we are going to learn. In-memory store means in your computer's hard disk or RAM, if you are storing your information, that is the data stores. Data stores, all these are. Where you are storing your data, that is data stores, okay? So I can put it at different locations, my information, well and good. But what is cloud storage is the question now, right? The entire concept is that only you need to understand first. The cloud storage is very important first. Generally, any database, if you create and you start storing the information, after few days it may say that insufficient memory, because the amount of space allocated for your database is, think so that 1 GB, 1 GB of space also finished. So it is unable to hold any more information in the database until and unless you extend the size of it. In your computer only, one that thinks so that 500 GB hard disk is there, and it is completely filled up. Some more information I want to store, there is no space. What should I do? You will purchase one more hard disk and you will attach to your computer. Inside that, some slots will be there. So there you are adding one more. So how much you purchased? 500 GB more. Actually, more 100 GB is required, but in future I may require it, so let me purchase. I thought that I have taken as 500 GB, but you have taken 400 GB cost extra you have utilized. You thought that in future might be I more else I may require. So automatically, if the memory size is increasing, that means the cost of that hard disk also increases. But less the cost, no, now I will take only 100 GB hard disk, I will attach it off. Then what will happen? 600, already 500 GB, this is 100 GB, 600 GB. So you are utilizing after that again, that is finished. Again, you need to go for purchasing one more and attaching, which is a time waste. And you, that is one, if it is not sufficient, again you need to go for purchasing. And there are no more slots to put this extra memory. Then again, if there is a limitation which I cannot do it. If I'm taking first only extra of 1000 GB, whether I may use or not, I don't know, but I may waste the money. So what is the solution for this? How much I require, that much only gradually I want to increase. So you don't maintain buffer, that memory, you take some memory for rent. Memory for rent from the cloud. Cloud is what, you know, it will give for rent for you. And how much utilize, that much only it will take the charge for you. That much, how much you have to pay is not, see, I after 5000 GB I have taken, and more 50 GB means only 50 GB extra you have utilized, means only for that you will pay for that. You will not pay for more 500 GB. So how much you use? Think so that I am entitled for 500 GB, but I used only 50 GB. So it will pay, ask to pay only for 50 GB, how much you use from the cloud storage, who will give for rent. So based on your usage only, bill will be there, but not fixedly for 500 GB I'll charge whether you use it or not. No, not like that. That is what advantage of the cloud storage, where there is no limitation that size is fixed, I cannot increase or decrease, there is no problem. When required, it will, they will provide extra space. When you don't require, they will decrease the space, and you are paying for how much you have been used only. So it's, and one more advantage is what, I don't require to do any maintenance task. My data, I'll put it in the cloud storage. With the cloud person, separately some people will be there who will take care of maintenance, security, privacy, everything they maintain. So we are out of our budget. So you can understand that how easy it becomes. So most of my works are maintained. Only I am accessing and I'm putting my data in the cloud storage. But maintenance of security, privacy, and if required, increase in the memory. If required, decrease in the memory size and pay, give it in the bill only for how much you have used. So that is will be taken care by the people who are the administrators of the cloud storage. Actually, for IBM, for Microsoft, there are some cloud storages are there which we are going to use. Actually, we are using those cloud storages also. Okay, so that is the advantage of not only for memory, what I am telling. There are many, many advantages of cloud storage. In this are not only accessing the memory, not only taking rent memory from the cloud storage, even you can take the infrastructure also. You can take infrastructure. That means I require in my company some infrastructure, high configured computer, but I don't want to pay. That architecture also, that configuration also, you can take it from the cloud storage. So you will pay for that infrastructure also. So I don't physically need to arrange in my from the office. That means in my company, but I can get the same architecture from the cloud storage so that I can utilize for my task to be done. So there are many, many advantages that you will understand in the next chapter. Okay, that means in this lessons only. So what we have learned is data source, but what are the techniques, what are the technologies you will use to access that information, to communicate with that data source? That is long back, we have learned this one in your C# console application, system.io, to interact with the files in binary mode or text mode to read or write. That is only system.io, plain text files if you want to work with. In case you want to work with the relational databases like that in long back work, okay? From our ASP application, if you want to connect with our databases, SQL Server or Oracle like that, we used to have ADO.NET. This is the coding part, special programs which are used to which helps me to connect to the database and do the our task. But nowadays, easiest one, lengthy code I need to write using ADO.NET. So is there any easiest method? Then we got entity framework which do the same task as ADO.NET but easily. Most of the works are automated. That is entity framework which we have learned in our ASP. There only you learn database first approach, model first approach, code first approach. So entity framework. In memory caches, I told you that in the ASP only you have learned caching also, data caching, whole page caching, and fragment caching. That data caching is nothing but in memory cache over here. Okay? So Windows, this is what Azure caching. In Azure portal also there will be some caching, memory will be there which you can utilize to make your application to store some repeatedly used data in the cache memory so that your application runs very, very, very faster. Why? Most of the important data is kept in the cache memory. Next time I will not disturb the server directly, I will take it from the cache memory. So that every time designing that data and connecting to different servers and getting the data is not required. First time I retrieve, let me put that in the cache memory. Next time if you want, take it from here. Don't ask me to again connect to the database and get it. So that is about different technologies with which you can interact with the data that is stored either in the relational database systems or in the plain text files, or it is in the XML files, or it might be in the cache memories. That means I can use different technologies to access the data. This is data access technologies. So any doubts here is my question. All of you please confirm. If you confirm, then only I will go for HTTP. What do you mean by HTTP? What do you mean by so basic services? I want to tell you, which are your third and fourth chapters are HTTP basic services creation, and fifth and sixth chapters are so basic services creation. So in before I'm going to that, did you understand data access, data stores, and data access technologies? Any doubt, you feel free and raise your hand and confirm me so that I'll take you on air and help you out. Boys and girls, little faster. So click on plus if you understood. And any doubts, raise your hand and write your query. Your query I will address. Preeti?
Hello?
Yes,
hello.
Preeti? So cache memory, you know, in everybody's computer was some cache memory. Adjust your camera, it is not okay.
Is it fine, ma'am?
Okay, leave it. When you are leaving, you are going down. See, your camera is putting you down when you are leaving it.
So it's moving automatically.
Okay, no problem. Don't worry, and you listen to me. In everybody's computer, cache memory will be there, like RAM only, but whatever data you kept it in the cache memory, you can put it in the cache memory very fastly and read the data from the cache memory very, very fastly when compared with RAM. That you know?
Yes,
so in the same manner, In the Azure, what you now in this module you are going to work with cloud storage with the help of the Azure portal. So everything will work with the cloud storage. That means our application will put it in the cloud storage from where everybody can access throughout the world. Understood? But the applications wants to access from the dashboard is not in your local computer. They want to access from the server. So they will take the cache memory of what your Azure portal. In the Azure portal also you have some cache memory. There it will put some frequently requested pages. So that next time same page is requested, it will come from the cache memory instead of request sent to the server. Got my point? Preeti, your video was having some problem, so it was disconnected. You rise, you tell me, did you understand or not? Even cache memory, not only in the client systems, even in the Azure portal cache also, you will be having cache memory where very important things you can put it in the cache memory and access from there always. So make our application works very, very faster. Preeti, you raise your hand and tell me, Joshine, no SQL means I told that non-relational databases. Your Microsoft SQL Server, these are the BMS database, right? Relational. But non-relational database management systems are also will be there from where things so that your MS Office access. It's RDBMS people will call, but not a pure RDBMS, it's a partial RDBMS. Such it from such type of non-relational databases also I want to interact. So I must use NoSQL. NoSQL means what? Non-relational databases. And no for not no, non-relational. Relational databases are different, non-relational databases are different. Non-relational databases, they will mention as no, what? SQL. No SQL means non-relational databases. Okay. Good. Now, we are moving ahead and remember, completely in your Azure, you are trying to create, I told you service means which is reusable. I want to create some service with some functionalities which I want to access from my application, from any of my application. I want to create service one with a number of functions. These functions I want to access from multiple applications of my, multiple applications. It's not required from a single application. I want access from multiple different applications. So first, as a developer, not accessing the service functions, you should have the knowledge how to create this service. So that is what is we are going to learn third, fourth, fifth chapter, services creation only. That's why your chapters also, Windows Azure, that time services creation also we used to tell. Working with services. So working with service, when somebody created service I am accessing is not sufficient as a developer. We should know how to create the services so that once you create, you can access from a number of applications in different manner. Okay. So those services creation time, if you talk about services, two types of services will be there for you. How many types of services for you? Two types of services will be there for you. So let me share my system. Okay. And I will write in a notepad, what are the different services do you have, you can create. What are the different types of services you can create? Actually, sir, is it share? Yes, services. The first one is, the first service is HTTP services, we'll call HTTP based services. HTTP services are HTTP based services, and another one is called as SOAP services. HTTP based services, once you create, those services are accessible by the consumer. Means you created one HTTP service, you want to access that service. How can you access? Compulsorily some protocol is required. Through internet, using some protocol, I can connect to your service and access. But what protocol? Only HTTP protocol. Only HTTP protocol with the help of which I can access your service. I cannot use any other protocol to connect to your service. Okay? So that is HTTP based services. Many advantages, security will be more in HTTP based services. And data will be, see, whenever I'm passing a request, request will be converted into standard format like XML or JSON, like that. It will be converted and it will be sent. So generally it will be sent in XML. All your requests, responses will be transferred. All requests and responses will be transferred between client and server in what format? XML format, which is a standard format. And it is only accessible using, only HTTP protocol is used to access it. I cannot use any other, other protocols to access the service. Whereas coming to the SOAP services, I can access with, here also the data communication will happen with XML or JSON. And another thing is, whenever you are creating this one, you can access them either using HTTP protocols or non-HTTP. I'm just writing as non-HTTP, don't get confused, okay? Non-HTTP protocols also. Some of the protocols are what? Non-HTTP, TCP, and named pipes. So some protocols will be there which will help. In what way it is best, madam, means certain times my application is in the website and I want to access through the internet that website. Throughout the globe, anybody is allowed to access it. So not only my branch members, so I must take the help through internet, I must access the service means, then I have to take it as HTTP. But TCP like that means I have created one service throughout the globe, everybody is not allowed to access, but it can be shared within the intranet. That means there are some 100 systems or in LAN connectivity in my branch. So in the server, I have created this service, which is SOAP service. I want to access this SOAP service, yes, you can access without, I don't require HTTP protocol, I can take TCP protocol. TCP protocol when I want to make my application only to be accessible within my intranet network, but not through internet, nobody is allowed to access through intranet. Within my local area net systems only, I want to access TCP protocol will use, which will restrict to your firewall. That means within your local area network only, you can be able to access that service. Certain times you want to access from other machines which are in the network like that. So that means within the same application, within my same computer, client is there, server is there. And I want to access from within the same system, from one application to see. In my same computer, I have two applications. This is one server, you think so. My computer is one server, in the two applications are there, one application want to interact with another application which is in the same server. So how the protocols generally will use to interact two applications with one another, whereas both the applications are in the same computer server. So how I can do that and named pipes like that. I want to restrict to that within the same computer only, they need to interact with each other. So that time named pipes. All these are possible if it is SOAP based services, whereas it is not possible. Where see, through intranet also you cannot directly access with the TCP protocol, you must use HTTP protocol if it is HTTP services. So two types of services, everything is having its own advantage. In what way advantage is there, next class I will tell you, okay? So there is one drawback here, actually it is slower in process. Why? Because it requires serialization. What do you mean by serialization? All these don't ask me. When we go for that, I'll tell. Okay? Deserialization, two processes are required when data is communicated between client and server. Whereas those are not required if it is a HTTP service. That is the main advantage that you have to understand. Okay? So is it clear what are the two different services do you have and what are the names means HTTP based services, SOAP based services. HTTP means you know that hypertext transfer protocol and SOAP means simple object access protocol. Okay, so like that two different and what are the differences when we go to third chapter and fourth chapter we will go ahead in that time. And not only that one, you should also remember that to access the data from different sources, we have already learned that link is the methodology with which I can access the data from whatever might be the data source. Long back, only Edward Everett means only from .NET application, Microsoft SQL Server, like that you can do. But if it is link, you can access from any type of data, either from the normal texture files or objects of a your class objects, or it can retrieve the data from XML files, it can retrieve the data from the database tables, like that from anywhere using the standard syntax it can access. These are the data technologies, what do we have. Any doubts you can tell me. In this one, do you have, this already I told. SOAP and HTTP basic services, this third lesson, some part of it I already told. Any doubts you can tell me. And once again, full. Simple Object Access Protocol, Rajnagar student, SOAP means Simple Object Access Protocol. So third lesson also I have, most of it I taught my dears, okay? Okay, Rajnagar. So services I told, service technologies means what, how can you create the services? There are two types of services you can create, that is HTTP based and SOAP based. That's what I already explained. But in this chapter, you are not going to learn how to create them. Just the meaning of them you are learning. And in third and fourth chapters, you are going to learn HTTP based services. And in the last one, you are going to learn, I mean, sir, not last, fifth and sixth, you are going to learn sixth of what SOAP based services creation. That is very, very important also, WCS. And I told you that in the notepad that HTTP based and SOAP based. Under HTTP based, what services we will create is, so we have ASP.NET Web API. What is that? ASP.NET Web API means it's the HTTP based services. In ASP, we were not learned that. Now we are going to learn that one. Okay, that is the path here. And what about the SOAP based service means WCF, Windows Communication Foundation. So that you will get it later. I'm just giving the brief introduction about it. SOAP based services and HTTP based services based on SOAP and XML based on, this is also like that only, XML text images like that, anything it can transfer. Uses a resource based approach, that means whatever files you are sending, it can be able to send. But same files it can send in the SOAP for what? XML format. And see here, remote call. That means any service which is remote call means I'll tell. The service is in one computer and you want to access from an application which is in another computer. So you are accessing a service which is in a remote computer. That time there are many techniques are there to invoke a service from which is in another system. You want access from your current application which is in another system. So that is called as remote procedure call. User from a remote system, I am calling a procedure. I am calling a function. That is called as invoking a remote procedure call. That means remote procedure call means only invocation of a method which is in a remote system. So that is the method you will apply. This is one more very important, I told what I called. If it is SOAP, I can use any type of protocols I can use for communicating with my application, I mean service. But whereas here you see HTTP is the underlying protocol for World Wide Web, you cannot use other than HTTP protocol to access this HTTP based services. You can use only HTTP protocol only, otherwise you cannot access it. So it is always accessible through the World Wide Web, that is through internet. So you can see that I already told you what it is, a web API, ma, ASP.NET web API. It comes under HTTP basis. This is HTTP based service. And whereas WCF is what? So this. So under HD basic services, we are going to learn ASP.NET Web API. Under the SOAP basic services, we are learning WCS. That is what we are going to learn till 6th module. Okay. So second module, code for entity framework. This is neither SOAP basic service or HTTP basic service that you learn from third module. But second module is totally framework. I told you already entity framework. You read all the topics of code first approach. Most probably will use code first approach, not database first approach, module first approach. You don't have in this. Only code first approach we are good. But meaning of them, you just read and see the code and come. Okay. So it is so base is a see. It is a SOAP based service and it uses many protocols, TCP protocol, inter-process IPC means don't get inter-process communication protocol. Inter-process means within the same application, within the same process, two threads want to communicate with each other, means to transfer some information. It is possible with a protocol called as IPC protocol, inter-process communication protocol. Okay, MSMQ means what? Anybody can guess and write MSMQ? Anybody heard this word, protocol name means you write? Anyway, I will tell now. I want you people to write if you have any guesses over here. Any guess, you please raise your hand and come write. No guesses, nothing, okay? Microsoft Message Queuing. Microsoft Message Queuing. Okay, that is the full form of MSMQ, correct? Microsoft Message Queuing, Message Queue, okay? Tane Center student, Guest05 wrote the correct answer, very good. That is Microsoft Message Queue. This is one protocol, like certain times you know that chatting you can do with your friend. But one is writing means other you need to, other has to read and then reply back. That means what this is, this type of communications in the chat are possible with the help of the Microsoft Message Queue. Think so that somebody is sending, my friends, today is my birthday, all my friends are sending me SMS. In which order I'll get it, all I'll get at a time? No, first come, first serve. So whoever sent for me first, that person's message I will receive first. Then second person, then third person, based on their time order. So think so that by the time they send the messages to me, my mobile is off. So they cannot reach my mobile. So what will happen? There will be for everybody's mobile, one queue will be created for you, inside which all your messages are going to be saved. And whenever you switch on the mobile, automatically from that queue, they will come in which order they entered into the queue, in the same order they will be received by your mobile. That is the advantage. That is the first come, first order service. In whichever order the messages are received by the queue, in the same order it will give it to you. Certain times, even though my mobile is on, still I am unable to access the messages sent by others. Why? Because my messages I am not deleting. It is messages and memory is finished. So it will tell, if you delete some of the messages, then I can take some other messages. It will give sometimes prompt also. Message queue is full. If you delete some of the messages, some more messages are waiting to come to your inbox. So if you delete some messages, you will get some messages which are in the queue in the same order. So that is for ensuring such type of first-come-first service, we will use another protocol called as Microsoft Message Queues. Okay? This type of ones also you will use in your Azure. We are having so many things advanced. Chatting also we can do in such a way that I'll say from here. From there, if you write the message, I can see from here. So that means from my application. I'm not saying that I will open my mobile. So if one application URL I'll give, using that URL, if you write message there, it will be visible in my system. So that type of many, many examples are there which you will see later. Okay? So that's about your third chapter. Any doubts till third chapter, I did the third lesson of the module one. And with this, we are going to come, if this means with this chapter, lesson four, your first module will be completed. Till now, I just told what do you mean by distributed applications, what are the advantages, what are the different layers. where can we store the data, and in which format you can save, and how you can access this data, that is data access technologies, AWS.NET, system.io, link technique, like that many we have learned, right? That is only generalized, but real one where I have stressed, can you write the name of it? This is what we are learning and I explained about it. What is the topic? Can everybody start writing that word? Then I'm explaining data access technologies. I explained one of it, very important, and this is what we are going to learn in our Azure, I said. I got answer from one student, Joshine, correct. But one word only is one word only you wrote, but something is there after that. Cloud storage, cloud computing. Devi, correct. Cloud storage, but now we are learning cloud computing, which I have already answered. I'll just say I have a very small company, budget is low budget company, and but a high end task I want to do. So infrastructure, I need to spend lot of amount on the infrastructure, whereas I know that in this year means 12 months. But my company requirement in only January, February, March, only in these 3 months, very high peak is there. That means people will request so many things from me. So I need to process their request. So for to process their request, I need high configuration computers. So I have purchased very nicely. I spent a lot of amount, but after 3 months, they are unused. So I have spent that much, but am I using throughout my year? No. For only 1 or 2 months sake, that much high cost machines you have purchased and you have spent a lot of amount on that, which is a wastage. So what should I do? So if only for those 2 months, is there any, from anywhere, can I get high configuration infra for rent so that I'll pay only how much I utilize? Certain times I will feel that this month I have found that many flow, the customers keep on increasing in my company, many orders, I was really attracted, I was surprised. Oh, I'm getting many customers, but I'm not processing very fast, so they're dissatisfied, so I want to improve my performance. So I have purchased so many things, but next month, very less orders. So whatever you have purchased is a waste. So how I can do it? Because I don't know when high peak will requirement will come, when low requirement will come, I don't know. At that moment, the best thing is cloud computing. In the cloud computing, infra can be taken for rent, softwares can be taken for rent. Are you understanding? Some memory can be taken for rent. So you can understand, instead of you are storing your information in your computer, put it in the cloud storage. Secure always, privacy always will be maintained. Nobody can ask, unauthorized users can access, because a team of members of the cloud storage is going to take care of security and this their work, okay? Not your work. Your headache also decrease, and I will lose my data. There is no doubt about it. You never will lose. That is privacy and security. Security in the sense what? Not only another case, I should not lose my data. Never I should lose my data. That is also a security. It's not somebody's, not my, that is not my question. They can view, but it I should not lose that information. So where it is better, where instead of I'm storing in my computer, due to some virus, my system hard disk corrupted, unrecoverable. Then I lost everything. So better you put it in the cloud storage. They will maintain a number of copies. One is failed also. Other one they will provide you. You don't require to think of them. How to maintain also. They will take care. Not only memory. I told that I'm doing some project in .NET for only 1 month. But I want to work with some alternate software, which is what licensed, compulsory. But licensed version of that, if I want to purchase it, 1 lakh like that, it into. For software, if I'm paying that much only for the month of, only for 1 month, afterwards I don't want that software, why should I pay that much? With a nominal fees of 1,000 like that, can I get that software 2,000 like that? Means then I can go for my cloud storage from where software also you can take for rent. So how many days you have utilized those many days only, for those many days only bill will be created and you have to pay only for that your usage. You will not pay even 1 rupee extra unnecessarily. Okay, so how much utilized, based on that only you are going to pay. That is also nominal fee. Okay, very nominal fee. So that is also cloud storage. Sometimes I want to increase my hard disk capacity, I want to increase my infrastructure, so configuration of my computer I want to increase to make my computer very faster, because that much peak requirement is there. But after a few days, this much high quality items I have purchased and there is no growth in my process, there are no customers. Whatever I have spent is a waste. If I'm reselling, I'll not get it that much. 50% also I'll not get. So how can I do it? Infrastructure also you can take it from your cloud computing. That is what cloud computing. Not only memory, infrastructure, as well as software also I can take it from the, take it for rent from your cloud computing. So that is what is the advantage of your cloud. So how much you require, more than little bit, thing so that if I want 1 GB, 1.1 GB like that it will provide cloud computing. Okay, if you are utilizing 1.3, 1.4 it will provide, because little extra it will provide, and it never you will get a concept of insufficient memory. So I should increase the size. Automatically they will provide you, they will increase your requirement size. Automatically in fraction of seconds they will increase. That is the advantage. See, if without cloud computing, if you are creating your own data center, your own data centers, if you are maintaining on your own, I don't want to take somebody's help, I want to maintain on my own. If you are very high, very big company, okay. But if you are a small company, it is costly and it is complicated and it's very, or high impedance means, or maintenance means what, so automatic maintenance means you can understand the thing, so that any problem is I have to go for repair, I want to increase the configuration settings for all the ways. One element if I'm taking high configuration not sufficient, that supported other elements also should be high configuration. So it becomes messy. I'm purchasing car for 5 lakhs, that's not sufficient. Am I able to maintain that petrol, whatever, how much I have to spend on that, am I able to spend on that? That is also maintenance will cost. So that maintenance, very low utilization, that much I'm doing, but might be that much of capacity one I'm taking, but very less I'm utilizing might be. All these are problems. Sometimes very low utilization, sometimes under utilization is what, no, you want some more extra data, but no, but sufficient memory is not available, sufficient configuration is not available. All the problems, either high or low problems, you will get it. That is. But if you take cloud computing, that's what a central data centers for providing of your services to be hosted. That means if you host your services over there, it is throughout the globe accessible. Like Yahoo.com, how you are accessing? You create your own ASP.NET application, you can host it in this cloud computing area. So that the one URL will be created throughout the globe, anybody can access. But through web portal, Azure portal only, it is possible to host your application in the central data center. I mean, central data centers means areas from where anybody can access. So how it is possible? Azure portal. Azure portal anybody can access? No. You should have either Hotmail ID or Outlook ID like that, and for which Azure subscription to be added. If it is added only with the same credentials of Hotmail or Outlook, you can enter into the portal called as Azure portal, manage Azure portal. So if at all subscription is not added for your Hotmail or Outlook, first of all, you cannot enter into Azure portal. If you can't enter into Azure portal, you cannot host your application in the cloud. You cannot put your database in the cloud. So that memory problems or software problems can be removed. Okay, so that in order to make it, you have to go for cloud computing. That is what on demand, are you understanding? On demand, I require more means on demand it will increase, and I require less means on demand it will decrease automatically. So I have to pay how much I have utilized. Only for that I am utilizing unlimited computation and storage. So there is no restriction that you are entitled only for this. If you ask me to increase, I'll increase, but I'll charge more, little more. Because you are utilizing more. If you are less utilizing, then I will pay only, I will give the bill only for that. That is what is the cloud computing which we are going to learn in our Azure. Okay, and fast on-demanding cost, that is what I want, same or repeated, low cost, better availability and elasticity means sorry, understanding. When you want to stretch, increase the capacity of existing one, you can immediately request so that memory can be increased, infrastructure can be changed as per your code. Even operating systems also you can access from your cloud storage. That is your advantage of the cloud. Any doubts, you can feel free and ask me. Ankit? Is there any doubt, Ankit? Ankit, adjust your camera. Are you there? Rahul, where is Ankit? Both of you are there or not? In what position the camera was arranged, I am unable to understand. From Kaupak. So I conclude that Ankit Raj is not there in this position and only the system is blocked. I can conclude that because you are not in a position to understand that he is on a adjust the camera, nothing is happening. Devi from Anna Nagar. Hi Devi, any doubts? Unmute your mic from Anna Nagar. No doubts, very good. Little increase the volume, but at the same time, a small question I'm asking. 1 minute only I will tell the scenario. You need to understand and you need to answer what you are you going to do at that situation. So there is a company for you in India, one company where 1,000 employees are working here. Same company, one more branch is in US. Okay, there also 1,000 workers are there. Okay, there also in US, 1,000 employees are there. Who is working in US branch and who are working in India branch, that is also 1,000 employees are there. So everybody should work with one system. So 1,000 computers, 1,000 configurations, everything I settled in India and in America. Also I am creating 1,000 systems. So total 2,000 systems infra I'm using in general. Okay. But is there, if at all, any possibility is there, so only 1,000 systems I'll arrange, but which can be used by Indian people as well as US people. So it is always, that means 1,000 machines cost you are decreasing. In what way, madam, is if you think? US people will work in the, for us, whatever time they are working is the night time. So in India, it is the morning time, if you think so, okay. We'll work at one time. That is night for us. When we stop working, they start working in the US, I think. So our computer is accessible by those people. That means same computer in the morning time as per India's time you are working. And after that, US people are using your computers to work with that. That means what is the meaning? You are utilizing the same machines by the two different people because your computers at the night time are not doing any work, they are in switched off mode. And you are not utilizing for 12 hours in the night. Whereas US people, they are utilizing other 12 hours. When you are shutting down your machines, they are working with their machine, other time their systems are waste. So instead of that, can I take only, since that one computer I am taking, which can be used by Indian people in the morning time, which can be used by night time by the US people. So only one computer utilization twice. That is called as the best utilization, which is, saves your cost and everything. So for that also cloud computing, that is also called as cloud computing. Okay. Got my point? Devi?
Yes, ma'am.
others please respond, did you understand? So like this also we can be able to do with the help of the cloud computing. So unused computers or anything are there, they will be automatically connected for the cloud when they have free time, so that they can work for others to do their other tasks, so that what will happen very, very fast, the works will happen. That's why unlimited we used to say. Okay, Devi, I got it. Anybody is having any more doubts? This is something which is not the book, I told you, because it is really important. So that's about cloud computing. So your application, if you host in your cloud, it is more secure. And throughout the globe, anybody can access. How much time do you take to host it is hardly 5 minutes. These are all the things you need to remember. And there is one diagram is in front of you. See the labels first. Blue color line is your cloud provide. How much is provided by your cloud computing, cloud storage one. Okay, how much it is providing. And green is your requirement of your application. See, whenever my green is going like that, always my cloud is providing little extra than what is required. Too much it is not providing, little extra. So you can see that how much is required, little extra it is there. Green is really required, blue is what is provided by cloud storage. But in case I'm not using the cloud, I'm using my application without the help of the cloud, then what will happen? Can you see these dotted lines which I'm writing? These are the times you have increased your, how much you increased it, madam, is here, my green till here well and good. When my green, my application usage is increasing, what to do at that time when the requirement is there, I have to increase this much, I have increased at that time, the so much I have, I cannot gradually increase as per your requirement. I have increased, but you are not utilizing that much. See here, this much you have, this much you can see that this much high you have made, but my green is not utilizing that much is not required, you are, see, my green at this point utilizing this much, so, but you have used, this much you have increased, so this much of amount is over extra you have given than required, and certain times underflow also, what is that? You have provided the requirement, you increase this late. Meanwhile, what was happened, it requires this much of amount, but that much you have not provided. After this, see, like this you have increased. By the time, it's insufficient memory. It's insufficient place. So that means you have been provided 1 GB without cloud. Now you are working, 1 GB is over, now you want 1.2, 1.3, but memory is not there, that is underflow. That means than or how much is required, that much is not sufficient, available with you. So the work will be stopped. So it will not process. So what's happening, you increase immediately 1 more GB. So 1 GB became 2 GB, that much hike you gave in the memory. You gave 1 GB, but it is really utilizing 0.2 or 0.3. So 0.7 GB you are not utilizing. So that is called extra unnecessarily you are providing. So that is that means unnecessarily you are wasting, or certain times if you are thinking unnecessary and you are giving less memory, it might not be sufficient. You will get problem when it is less than required sufficient as amount of space is there. Or too much of space you provide but you are not utilizing. So you have spent more but utilization is less. So I have taken full meals but my capacity is only plate meals, not even plate meals. So I have paid for full meals but I have not eaten this much also. Entire thing is a waste, so it is a waste only. But how much I am eating based on the quantity, if that person is giving the bill, that is always good. Neither I will waste. Nor I'll feel that I am getting up without filling my stomach. Understood? So this cloud is also like that. Based on your requirement, automatic elasticity, it increases or decreases as per your requirement and how much you are utilizing any point of time. For that, it will pay the charge. That is about your cloud computing. You can see there are situations graphically telling, unpredictable, certain times very fast growth in my company. So very fast growth means what? I need to immediately increase my demand. My demand is increasing, very fast growing. But certain times up and down, unpredictable. unpredictability increases, unpredictability decreases. Unpredictability increases, decreases. At that time, how much capacity I should provide if it is without cloud? It's very difficult. Sometimes I'll increase, sometimes I'll decrease. If I'm decreasing, again it is increasing. So that is unpredictable. Certain times my company's requirement will become like that. So sometimes they will go very high, and sometimes very fastly they will dip down. Again requirement increases, again requirement decreases. This is unpredictable one. Okay, sorry, predictable burst. Unpredictable means what you see. This is keep on always up and down. I know that means in these months my company sales will be more, in this month my company sales always will be less. Yes, you think of it. In rainy days, it will be decreased sales, and if it is a hot summer, then it will be increased. That is predictable, anybody predict. But these are certain times unpredictable. So smoothly, certain times very fast it will go and very fast it will dig down. That is unpredictable. Okay, so this type of situation, this is what gradual, periodical, as I already told, if it is sweaters means what in the that means in rainy season like that I will use more. Okay, if it is at the same time the same will not be that much sales, you will not get it if it is hot summer. Who will go for sweaters? Nobody will go for sweaters. So season based wise, if it is coming, means that is periodical processing. This type of situations when you have your cloud elasticity is going to help you. So if it is increased immediately, abnormally if it is increased, that time also your cloud will help you out. That is, it itself will automatically increase the size. When you don't want, it will decrease. That's the reason we will go for cloud elasticity. In certain cities, in all these type of situations, who is the best is the cloud elasticity. So you need to go for cloud computing. That is what. Any doubts still here? And this means I'm going to show you and I'm explaining you. With this I'll stop for today. In the cloud, what are you going to take for rent? How much you are arranging on your own in your machine, how much you are taking for rent from the cloud storage? Everything are you taking for rent from your cloud storage, or some of your application requirements let me provide in my system directly, only few I will take it for rent from the cloud. Based on how you are going to take, this is the diagram. The first diagram, blue color always, which is you are providing on your own. Keep it here, blue means which you are providing on your own. On-premises means what? Now everything, see here, blue is managed by you, not by self. And green is managed by vendor. Vendor means what? This cloud computing vendors, IBM vendors who have the cloud storage, that means data warehouses. So those blue, in the first, generally, if you don't utilize the services of the cloud, this is on-premises means on your computer, everything you maintain. Applications, database, runtime, that means operating systems, middleware, everything, infrastructure you have to maintain if you are not taking anything from the cloud. There are another things, infrastructure as a service means application, data, everything I will take maintain on my machine, but only infrastructure like operating system, anything which I require, cloud storage, I will take it from where? From the cloud. Everything I will not take from cloud. My application will be in my computer only. My application will not be, I don't want to maintain in my cloud. I want to maintain in my local computer. Data also I want to maintain, only infra. I want to take it from the cloud and I want to maintain they aren't required infrastructure to me. So that is called as IaaS. IaaS means infrastructure as a service. IaaS. Some engineering students will have the IaaS, PaaS, SaaS. PaaS means what? Platform as a service. Where only application data I will maintain. Rest all runtime environment, my processor, everything. Who will do it? I will take it from my cloud. So very less I will maintain my application data and my application. I will maintain rest of execution part, operating system, cloud storage, everything I will take it from the cloud. And last one, software as a service. N of max of M setting my application, my data, my operating system, my runtime details, my storage, everything I'll take it from my cloud. That is the people will call it as software as a service. SaaS. Okay. How to pronounce while writing, how the people will write. I'm just writing here shortcut notation. I capital I A A S infrastructure as a service, P A A S platform as a service, S A A S that means software as a service. These are the shortcut names you can see. In any engineering people might be faced these words because some of you are having this subject as a common. So cloud computing, there you will get all these things. Okay. So that is about IaaS, PaaS and all these. See, in the on-premises, nothing you are accessing from the cloud. In the second one, certain your application data, runtime environment, your processor, operating system will be on your operating, your, I mean Windows, everything is in your. But madam, I want to execute in Linux, whereas I don't have Linux in my system. Even Linux, I want to take it from the cloud. Only application that I want in my local computer, but I don't have the Linux operating system. I don't have runtime. Everything I want to rest other than my application on data, I want everything from my cloud. I want to take it. Then I can go for the third one. That is second one, platform as a service and various software service, including my software also I'll take it from the cloud. My application also I'll maintain in the cloud. I will maintain my data in the cloud. My database I'll maintain in the cloud. My operating system I'll maintain in the cloud. Everything I will maintain in the cloud. That is software as a service. So green means what everything you are maintaining in the, whatever you have mentioned with green, that is maintained by the vendor. So your application also is maintained by vendor. That's about today's session. And rest of the topics of second chapter, I am going to help you in the next class, okay? So okay, these are the small theory topics you can read, only that only left, and everything I have already told you, distributed cache, content delivery, advantages of your cloud storage. Each one you have the seed, the SQL database also you can maintain in the cloud so that everybody can access the database, not only you can maintain in your local computer. That all is the part. Tomorrow I'm going to show you that example also. Sitting there you can access the application which is created in my system, because I'll host it in the cloud computer, cloud storage, with the help of Azure portal, so that I will share that URL, you can access that application from your system. If you have internet connected, that's enough. In front of you I will host it and I'll show you in tomorrow's session, and then I'll start with entity framework. Okay, any doubts in today's session, please raise your hand and confirm me. Please raise your hands and confirm me. Do you have any doubts? So only what, see, it's already time 12:55. I'm ending the session. Any doubts, you put it in the group, Azure group. Okay. So I will help you out by looking at that group. I'll check your doubts and I'll clear. This is only theory topic which we will learn. Tomorrow onwards, completely practical oriented, okay? So even Azure portal also I will show you how to host your application, how it will be throughout the globe, anybody can access, I will show you, okay? So have a nice day all of you. Tomorrow at the same time, 11 o'clock, we will meet for our tomorrow's session, where we will learn entity framework and hosting your application. So give your feedback now.